Hey there, AP Environmental Science class. All right, welcome back to my lecture on Chapter 3, Ecosystems. So we left off with this slide, what happens to energy in an ecosystem. So energy flows through ecosystems in food chains and food webs. So what are food chains and food webs? A food chain is movement of energy and nutrients from one trophic level to the next, while a food web is a network of interconnected food chains. Okay, so that's the difference between the two. So here is basically what we talk about when we talk about these trophic levels. All right, so once again, you have solar energy, which is the sun, okay, that high quality energy coming from the sun. I also want to point out as we go through this, there's your little heat. Okay, that's what degrades the energy. Okay, remember a high quality energy from the sun gets degraded to lower quality energy as it keeps going, because a lot of the energy is released as heat into the environment and is lost. So your first trophic level are your producers, are your plants. We then go to the second trophic level, which are your primary consumers, your herbivores. Then the third trophic level, the secondary consumers, carnivores. And then our fourth trophic level are your tertiary consumers, which are your top carnivores. So here it's a hawk. Obviously, humans are a tertiary consumer. Sharks, for instance, in the ocean would be tertiary consumers as well. And then we have our decomposers and our detritus feeders, okay, that decompose and feed on dead animals and dead plants that then recycle that back into the soil for nutrients. There we go. For, again, plants and animals to be able to use. Okay, so that's kind of how we go through those trophic levels. So every use and transfer of energy involves energy loss as heat. I've been saying it since the last chapter. I will continue to say it because it's very important. Pyramid of energy flow, 90% of usable energy lost with each transfer. Think about that, okay? Less chemical energy, the higher you go in the trophic level. Biomass, just a definition for you, total mass of organisms in a given trophic level. So let's talk about this in a little more detail. All right, this chart explains it very nicely. You'll notice the producers, the cytoplankton on the bottom, right? Okay, here's your usable energy available in kilocalories, about 10,000 kilocalories of energy available. You go up to the next trophic level, your primary consumers, and it drops, okay? It only 90% we lose, okay? You only retain 10% of the energy. So by the primary consumer trophic level, you only get 1,000 kilocalories. Then by the secondary consumer trophic level, it's down to 100. And by the time you get to us, the tertiary consumers, that usable energy has been reduced to only 10 kilocalories. So this is very important as we begin to talk about what type of lifestyle we want to live. So why in that ecological footprint survey did many of us people who eat a lot of meat use a lot of earths? The problem is because eating meat, okay, is you're up here in these higher trophic levels. So the energy you get from the meat is much less, and therefore you have to eat much more. While people or the primary consumers, the plants, if you're eating plants, you actually are getting more energy per unit value of that plant compared to eating red meat. Okay, and this is one of the reasons, there are a couple of reasons, but this is one of the reasons why eating red meat is not that great for the planet, because by the time you get up there in the trophic level, there's not as much energy available, so you have to eat more and more and more of it. While if we just ate plants, there's actually more energy available in those plants. Okay, and once again, as we go through the course and we talk more about food production and things like that, we will get into this in a bit more detail. All right, so here's an example of a food web in the ocean. Okay, again, you can just see how we have humans at the top. Okay, kind of your here are your krill and your cytoplankton. Okay, your zooplankton that are eaten by fish, and then obviously everything is interconnected here. Leopard seal. Okay, eats the penguins. All right, eats squid. But the elephant seal will eat the leopard seal, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So what this is important, or why this is important to us, is because what we're going to learn when we get to some other chapters in succeeding chapters here, is that if you take out the elephant seal, let's say, from this food web, Well, you completely mess up the food web, right? If you take rid of the emperor penguin from the food web, well, then the food web gets disrupted. Okay, and so we'll talk about how when animals become extinct, okay, or we don't have as many of them in the population, your biodiversity decreases, it messes up these food chains and it messes up these food webs, which then have cascading effects downstream, right? So if the leopard seal goes and the elephant seal can't eat it, well, then the killer whale eats both of them, well, then what's going to happen to it? It goes, et cetera, and the entire food web collapses. And that's what we don't want, okay? What happens to energy and ecosystem? Again, just another example of a food web. That was an aquatic one. This is a terrestrial one in a forest. But again, you have the prickly pear cactus kind of been eaten by this wood rat, which gets eaten by this lizard, which gets eaten by the red-tailed hawk, et cetera, et cetera. You take out the wood rat, okay? It becomes extinct or its numbers diminish. Well, then obviously the lizard has issues. The grasshopper mouse will then have issues, the red-tailed hawk will have issues, et cetera, because everything is interconnected, these webs. That's why it's called a web, right? You've seen a spider web. It's all interconnected and intertwined, and that's exactly what happens. If you go to a spider web and you cut a hole in one part of the spider web, the whole web collapses, right? Okay, same thing happens with these food webs, and that's why all organisms are important, because everything is interconnected. You may not think the prickly pear cactus has anything to do with the red-tailed hawk. Well, guess what? It definitely does. You get rid of that cactus, that red-tailed hawk is going to be in big trouble because you're getting rid of the food that it preys on. Okay, all right, so some ecosystems produce plant matter faster than others do, all right? So there are two terms we're going to learn. One is the gross primary productivity, the GPP. This is the rate at which an ecosystem produces, or at least an ecosystem's producers, okay, those autotrophs, convert solar energy to stored chemical energy. It's the rate measured in units such as kilocalories per meter squared per year. The other term we need to know is called the net primary productivity, the NPP. So this is the rate at which an ecosystem producers convert solar energy to chemical energy minus the rate at which they use the stored energy for their own aerobic respiration. Okay, so we're going to be concerned more with the net primary productivity of things compared to the gross. Because again, the net will take in not only the rate at which the producers convert that solar energy to the stored chemical energy, to that glucose, right? But it's also the rate at which the organism will use their own stored energy, okay? Terrestrial ecosystems and aquatic-like zones differ in their NPP. The planet's net primary productivity ultimately limits the number of consumers, including humans, that can survive on Earth, okay? It actually limits the carrying capacity of the planet. What I wanted to show you here, this chart is very important. And the reason it is I want you to look. I want you to look at, here are your average net primary productivity, okay? And look at in the terrestrial and the aquatic ecosystems, which are the three that have the greatest net primary productivity, meaning they're creating the most producers, right? Okay, the most plant matter. Swamps and marshes and tropical rainforest in the terrestrial ecosystems, estuaries, okay, in the aquatic ecosystems. What do you think are the three ecosystems that we're destroying the fastest? Yeah, swamps and marshes, tropical rainforest, and estuaries. We are destroying these the most, the quickest. Okay, we're draining swamps and marshes to put up buildings, to put down, to be able to plant crops. We talked about the tropical rainforest earlier in this chapter. Estuaries, okay, are again that kind of boundary between freshwater, saltwater, right? We're destroying them. Okay, not only is pollution destroying them, but again, we're draining them to plant crops. We're draining them to put in condos. Okay, and apartment complexes, yet these are the ecosystems that produce plant matter faster than everything else, right? Look at the tundra, Arctic and Alpine. We're not, you know, doesn't produce as much plant matter, okay? Desert scrub, not producing as much. Savannah, you know, kind of in the middle there, all right? So what I find so interesting and so scary is that the ecosystems that are produce the most plant matter, have the greatest NPP, net primary productivity, are the ecosystems we're destroying the fastest. Not good. Not good at all. All right, so let's talk about what happens to energy in a food chain. Again, we kind of did talk about this a little bit. The ecological efficiency is the percentage of energy transferred from one trophic level to the next in an ecosystem. And again, we talk about this 10% rule. Most of the energy is lost as waste heat, right, into the environment. We can't get it back. Some energy is contained in detritus and metabolic waste, provides energy for decomposers and those detritivores. Okay, but I want to go back to this 10% rule. I want to back up a couple of charts and again, just prove to you, here's your 10% rule. If you do 10,000 times 10%, we get 1,000. You get 1,000 times 10%, 100. 100 times 10% is 10. Okay, so this is the 10% rule. Only 10% of the energy from one trophic level makes it to the next higher trophic level. All right, and that's very important, again, as we talk about going through and we talk about food production and land use and things like that. So what happens to matter in an ecosystem? Nutrients cycle within and among ecosystems. These cycles are driven by incoming solar energy and gravity, can be altered by human activity, obviously. And the four main cycles that we're going to talk about are the water cycle, the carbon cycle, the nitrogen cycle, and the phosphorus cycle. So we're going to talk about each one in a bit more detail. So first, we'll talk about the water cycle. The water cycle sustains all life. The hydrologic cycle collects, purifies, and distributes Earth's fixed supply of water. Okay, we are not gaining water here on the planet, nor are we losing it. It is fixed. Okay, we have the same amount. It's just we are polluting it, or maybe some of it is so far underground we can't get to it. And we'll talk about that more when we get to water usage in a couple of chapters. Incoming solar energy causes evaporation. Gravity then draws water back as precipitation. Surface runoff evaporates to complete the cycle, or some of that precipitation ends up getting stored in groundwater or these aquifers that we'll talk about that people use to get fresh water. So here's again a picture of the water cycle. This should also bring you back to your middle school days, okay, earth science. Again, here's just the evaporation, precipitation, your condensation, your runoff, your infiltration into the groundwater, into the aquifers, okay, etc., etc. All right. Ways human alter the water cycles. How do we mess around with it? We withdraw large amounts of fresh water from aquifers at rates faster than nature can replace it. Again, water is a renewable resource, but not if you take it all out at one time, okay? You need to leave some in so that it can purify itself and renew itself. Clearing vegetation increases runoff, okay? So this changes the water cycle, all right? When you clear cut or when you put in parking lots, okay, what's going to happen to that water? It's not going to seep into the ground. It's going to run off, right? Because unfortunately, asphalt is not permeable to water in most cases. Draining and filling wetlands for farming and urban development. We spoke about that. Wetlands provide flood control, but also are the greatest areas of NPP, that net primary productivity. They also absorb and hold overflows of water. So we mess around with the water cycle when we drain and fill wetlands because, again, those wetlands provide flood control for us. Okay, that's one of the ecological services that wetlands provide for the earth. All right, next cycle we're going to talk about is the carbon cycle. All right, carbon cycles among living and non-living things. Carbon is the basic building blocks of carbohydrates, fats, proteins, DNA, and other organic compounds. Remember, except for methane, you have to have two carbon atoms, and then you're considered an organic compound. Photosynthesis from producers remove carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. So we all learned that in elementary school, right? The trees bring in the carbon dioxide, and then aerobic respiration by producers, consumers like us, and decomposers, we add that carbon dioxide back into the atmosphere. Some of that carbon dioxide does dissolve in oceans, okay? It is stored in marine sediments, all right? And what we're actually learning is that the warmer the oceans get, the worse they are at sequestering or dissolving that carbon dioxide back into the ocean. So here's more of that positive feedback, okay? The warmer the ocean gets, the less carbon dioxide can be sequestered, warming the waters up more, less carbon dioxide, bada bing, bada boom, and here we go, okay? And you have that positive feedback, which increases or keeps increasing the carbon dioxide levels in the atmosphere. So here is, again, your carbon cycle, okay? Once again, deforestation, transportation, forest fires add to carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. You're burning fossil fuels, obviously add to it. Okay, but we do have some areas that sequester or take in the carbon. So again, photosynthesis will take in carbon dioxide into plants. Okay. For instance, diffusion out of the atmosphere into the ocean, dissolving it into the ocean will also sequester some of that carbon dioxide. Okay, so make sure you understand these cycles. My advice would be when you're studying to just kind of go through these pictures that you see and just make sure you kind of understand where things are going. Humans have disrupted the carbon cycle, obviously. We've added larger quantities of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere at a faster rate than the natural processes can remove or sequester that carbon. Levels have been increasing sharply since about 1960. The result, warming atmosphere and a changing climate. Clearing vegetation obviously also reduces the ability to remove excess carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. We're going to do a fun lab investigation with this chapter. We're actually going to go outside here on the Ardsley campus, and we're going to measure, or we're going to estimate how much carbon is sequestered by the trees that we have here on campus. And then we're going to compare that to the amount of carbon dioxide we release by just driving to and from school. So we're going to count all the cars in the parking lot, and we're going to compare that to, again, the data we'll obtain by going out and actually measuring the size or the diameter of tree trunks, and then we'll be able to use a formula to basically compare how much carbon is being sequestered by the trees here on campus compared to how much carbon we're putting out into the air. Again, there'll be rough estimates, but I think it's a good activity to kind of drive home this point of how we are disrupting the carbon cycle. All right, the nitrogen cycle is the third cycle. We'll talk about bacteria in action. So useful forms of nitrogen are created by lightning and specialized bacteria in the topsoil and bottom sediment of aquatic systems. Nitrogen, very important. If any of you have gardens, you know that nitrogen is one of the main fertilizers or main ingredients you need for good soil. Nitrogen used by plants to produce proteins, nucleic acids, and vitamins. Bacteria convert nitrogen compounds back into nitrogen gas, okay? This is that cycle. This is that nitrogen cycle. So, of course, we've altered the nitrogen cycle by burning gasoline and other fuels. We create nitric oxide, which then can return to the Earth's surface as acid rain, increasing potentially the nitrogen or putting too much nitrogen back into the soil. We also remove large amounts of nitrogen from the atmosphere to make fertilizers. We also add excess nitrates into aquatic ecosystems. Those fertilizers then run off into aquatic ecosystems, adding excess nitrates, which again isn't necessarily good for the ecosystem. We'll talk more about that in upcoming chapters. Human nitrogen inputs to the environment have risen sharply and are expected to continue rising. So again, here's just a picture of the nitrogen cycle. Again, I would definitely have a general idea of this. I've seen FRQs that talk about, you know, basically describe the nitrogen cycle, okay? So again, you'll notice the nitric oxides into the atmosphere, electrical storms actually get some of that nitrogen out into the ground, okay? Decomposition or decomposers help do that, okay? Nitrification is a term that we'll use it in some succeeding chapters to talk about this a bit more by bacteria, okay? The nitrogen then uptake by the plants, etc., etc. All right, so again, take a look at this this picture and just understand the basic tenets of the nitrogen cycle. Last cycle we'll talk about is called the phosphorus cycle. It cycles through water, rock, and food webs. Phosphorus cycles through water, the Earth's crust, and living organisms. Major reservoir is phosphate rocks. And this is a very slow cycle. So unlike the water cycle, the carbon cycle, and the nitrogen cycle, the phosphorus cycle takes many, many years. Human activities and impacts, clearing forests obviously disrupt the phosphorus cycle, removing large amounts of phosphate from the earth to make fertilizers, messing with that cycle. Erosion leaches phosphates into streams, which of course disrupts that cycle and adds phosphates to areas that we do not want phosphates added to. All right. So once again, just another picture for you showing it, showing you what we're talking about. Okay, erosion, phosphate dissolved in water used by some plants and some animal consumers and bacteria, but also mining waste puts excess phosphates through runoff back into our water. Sewage will put excess phosphates back into our water. Phosphates and fertilizers, okay, we'll put that extra phosphate back into our water, all right, and all these processes disrupt the natural phosphorus cycle that has been around for millions and millions of years. All right, so those are the cycles. The last part of this chapter, rather simple, how do scientists study ecosystems? Just some information for you here, methods of study, field research, actually going into forest and natural settings. And again, we're going to do a little bit of that on our campus here at Ardsley High School. Laboratory research, so in the lab, mathematical and other models will then be created to help study to study ecosystems and how they interact with one another and how these cycles, again, are being disrupted and what happens when these cycles are disrupted. We use those mathematical and other models to kind of predict what we're going to think happens. Other study tools, aircraft, satellites, GIS software, GPS systems to track where animals go, etc., etc. And the last slide here, ecologists do laboratory research and use models, model ecosystems and populations under laboratory conditions, simplified systems with control, temperature, light, humidity, other variables, and again, supported by the field research. You still got to go out into the field, but then you can take that data back and kind of put them in some models and kind of play with that a little bit to see what happens with some controlled environments and some other variables. And again, those mathematical models can then simulate ecosystems, and this is a way we can study large and complex systems over let's say years, tens to hundreds to thousands of years by creating these mathematical computer models. All right, so that is the end of chapter 3. I hope you enjoyed, and I'll see you guys soon.